Hello and welcome to coverage of Grand Prix of Pro Tour Born of the Gods. Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Randy Buehler. Welcome, Marshall, to the booth.
Yeah. Apparently, welcome back.
Thought I was at a GP for a minute there. We have, let's see, Arjan Van Leeuwen. He's playing an innovative mono blacklist here that we haven't really seen much of for modern.
No, it is the Rack times 8. It is Thoughtseize, Inquisition of Kozilek, Raven's Crime, Wrench Mine. It's a four of in this deck.
So sweet. And he's playing against Samuel Pardee, who is on the deck that he's won a Grand Prix with, which is Moira Pod.
Absolutely. And so Inquisition of Kozilek grabs Bird of Paradise. We see two lands, Kitchen Finks. Is that Abrupt Decay, Scavenging Ooze Ranger?
Yep, that's exactly what it looks like to me. And obviously, Arjan Van Leeuwen looking to try to slow down his opponent as much as possible.
Take
to
a
get
look
those
at that
discard
hand.
Land, those discard hands.
He's got the second Swamp. He's got the Bob. Shrieking Affliction is an enchantment that has the same basic effect as the Rack.
That's right.
There's Wrench Mind, which is discard two. I wonder how many artifacts Sam Pardee has to discard so that it would only be one.
I mean, I'm sure he's fine if he discards a Birthing Pod to it, right?
Yeah, sure. I don't think Van Leeuwen will be upset about that.
No.
Yeah, and smallpox. So this is a pox deck, if you will, but with smallpox, it's discard in the Rack. It's what every 12-year-old was playing in 1995, basically. I'll just knock all the cards out of your hand and kill you with the Rack.
That's right. And Wrench Mine does resolve, and the end result of that is a Ranger of Eos and Scavenging Ooze hitting the graveyard, and we're gonna pass a turn back to Van Leeuwen here, who finds a Thoughtseize, and he reveals there's a Kitchen Finks, a Spellskite, Abrupt Decay, and a Gavinny Township for Sam Pardee. And it looks like Kitchen Finks is going to be the one to go as Arjan passes the turn back, prompting Sam Pardee to crack his Verdant Catacombs and go get a land. He's going to get a fresh draw step, but his hand doesn't have a whole heck of a lot going on after it's been relatively torn apart here by Arjan.
True. And Arjan plays a
the Affliction.
Shrieking Affliction. Thank you.
Yeah, a few cards in here that we don't see pop up very often in Modern. No doubt about that.
No, Wrench Mind was not expected. Oh, wow. Tim Rivera has already assembled the entire Splinter Twin combo. Bang, up a game against Jinwei Zhang. Those guys are on 10-3, as are the players that we're watching right now. So fourth loss, probably not completely fatal. Fourth loss, though, you got to trust your tiebreakers and hope and cross your fingers. These guys definitely want to win the next two rounds and then hope they can just draw the last one.
Okay. Dark Confidant here for Arjan is going to be eaten by the Abrupt Decay. He had to anticipate that, but no reason not to play it.
Yeah, they're Shrieking Affliction.
Sam Pardee has no play for the turn, says go. Van Leeuwen draws a Swamp for his turn. Looks like he has another Wrench Mind.
Of course he does. That would turn on the Affliction if it's what he has.
It is indeed.
Oh, an artifact.
Yeah.
Spellskite. Doing work.
And Mutavault also doing work, getting in there for a couple of damage.
Yeah, Wrench Mind is discard two or discard an artifact.
Right.
As a limited card in an artifact-heavy environment, it wasn't even particularly good.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, it's
but here in Eternal format.
It's almost always discard two for BB.
That's right. Now, Mutavault, gets in there for a couple more, and there's an actual Rack.
Yep.
One, yes, 14.
So Sam takes a bunch of damage there, right?
He does. Sam Pardee down to 14 life here. And there's a Thoughtseize in the smallpox still sitting in Arjan's hand, and he's going to Thoughtseize first and see
nothing.
Triple land from
land,
Sam Pardee.
Land. He has knocked every relevant spell into the graveyard. Has Sam even cast a spell this game? Cast an Abrupt Decay, I guess.
He did, yeah.
It's the only spell that has managed to dodge the discard.
Yeah, that's right.
But, I mean, Sam holding on to the bunch of land, so he's able to get out of range of the Affliction and the Rack. Mutavault, though.
Doing work.
Chipping away.
Yeah, it looks like Sam's down to 10 here. And there's a Birthing Pod off the top for Sam Pardee.
Four.
All right, looks like Ansi.
Alkio? Oh, the Finnish player.
Alkio from Finland has also put together the Splinter Twin combo to beat Raymond Tan in game one, so he's up a game.
Yeah, I believe Alkio is undefeated in Modern.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's 7-0. I think there's three players that are 7-0.
Is that an ensnaring bridge?
That is an ensnaring bridge.
And now a smallpox as well.
Jeez. So smallpox is a creature, a land, and a card.
And I think everybody loses a life too, yeah. Each player loses one life, discards a card, sacks a creature, and then sacrifices a land.
Done? Yep. Now, can Sam get out of this with a creature? I mean, obviously, he's got the Birthing Pod. The namesake super powerful card in his deck, but right. He has no creatures. He drew Casali Pride Mage.
I'm going to play this and pay two life to pot it, but I'm going to find Kitchen Finks, so I'll stay at nine.
All right, so he's going to basically get rid of it, upgrade it to a Kitchen Finks, lose no life in the process, and give himself a bit of a board state here.
Yep, he can block Mutavault now.
Mm-hmm. And he's also got double food for Birthing Pod for turns to come here. So maybe a little bit of momentum here for Sam Pardee.
And now remind us exactly what Ensnaring Bridge does.
Yeah, so I'll just read it for you. Shortly.
This persists, I gain two.
It says, creatures with power greater than the number of cards in your hand can't attack. Now,
is that for each player, though?
No, it's just a general thing.
It sits on Lewis's hand.
For each player, correct. Yeah, it just sits there and says, creatures with...
Which means Mutavault can't even attack
right,
here.
Right, it can't.
All right, so the pod, the Kitchen Finks was sacrificed to the pod, came back because of Persist. Sam gained two more life and got a counter. He went to get a red cap as his potted creature. Yeah, drawing a creature to start potting. This game looks spectacular for Van Leeuwen, but Birthing Pod off the top, followed by creature off the top, and Sam has been smart enough to just play the bare minimum of land so he can stay out of range of the Rack and the Shrieking Affliction.
Mm-hmm. Keeping himself at a comfy 11.
Third
life.
Copy of the Rack. Now, Van Leeuwen needs to top deck some discard and turn his damage back on. Sam, meanwhile, looks like he drew a wall of roots.
Mm-hmm.
So he's starting to close in on assembling some scary stuff. Now, Sam's playing the Malira Pod version of the pod deck. He sacrifices the red cap so he can go get a 5, and Revelark is going to be the 5 of that he gets. Now, does he have the Archangel combo in his deck as well? Now, I'm not sure he does. I think he might just... A lot of these pod decks will play a Spike Feeder and an Archangel of Thune, which is an infinite life combo that also makes all your creatures infinitely large.
I see.
I mean, arbitrarily large. He does not have access to that combo, so I was thinking of the 5 might have been an Archangel. A lot of decks would go get Archangel there. But Revelark is still quite good. I mean, in terms of a combo kill for Sam, it basically has to be a Malira Silvok Outcast, a Sacrifice Outlet, and a Persist creature. Okay. That's what he needs.
So he has one of those three.
Yeah,
because he needs a repeatable
creature.
Sacrifice Outlet.
Right, so which is basically a Vizara Seer, and often there's a second one. He might be just on the single...
On the Vizara Seer?
Single Vizara Seer, right. He can go get it with a Ranger of Eos, in theory. But did his Ranger of Eos go to the graveyard? But his Ranger of Eos went to the graveyard early on.
That's right.
Now here's Voice of Resurgence.
It gets insta-potted.
Another fine creature to sacrifice to Birthing Pod, because it leaves behind a token. Star token equal to the number of creatures you have. Now he can go get a 3. He's looking at, Eternal Witness, and he's looking at Kitchen Finks.
Okay.
That's what's his debate. I saw him flip those to the front of his deck. Eternal Witness could go get the Ranger Vios to go get the Vizara Seer in theory, but he just wants to defend his life total and make sure he doesn't die to a random discard spell that knocks him into the range of the Rack.
I see. The Racks, as it were.
The Racks, yes.
And there is a discard spell off the top here for Arjan. It's another Wrench Mind.
Yep. Discard 2.
2 lands down.
Right. Now, that does not turn Shrieking Affliction on. You have to be at 1 or less for that one. But it does mean the Racks are going to deal... The Rack deals 1 damage each?
Two. Take 2?
Yeah.
11, right? Yep.
All right, that drops Sam Pardee down to 11. Still in a reasonable position
here. Yeah, I mean, and a lot of times... we talk about the combo kill, and you know, that's kind of the headline for these pod decks, but often they're just able to win by attacking with these random creatures. You get so much card advantage from Birthing Pod, you're just constantly 2-for-1, 2-for-1, 2-for-1. But in Snaring Bridge, has actually shut that plan down.
It has. I can't tell you how many times I've played against Birthing Pod, done everything I could to shut off the combo, and then lost to Gavinny Township on a couple of Birds of Paradise or something along those lines.
And in terms of blowing up an Ensnaring Bridge, Sam has only the one Casali Pride Mage, and it's actually already in his graveyard. Mm. So it's like, okay, he can Eternal Witness for it, but I don't know that he can blow up both of those. Now, that token that was left behind by the Voice of Resurgence is zero CMC. Uh-huh. Sacking it to the pod lets him get a Vizaras here. So he is now one Malira away.
Yeah.
All
right, so Viscerous here on the battlefield is going to get sacrificed, and also Revelark is. So that's going to get both of those back. Yeah. Do 2 damage to Arjan, drop him down to 10.
Fetch a forest, pay 2 life for this, and then pay 2 more life.
New birthing pod. Sack the bird, go get Malira.
Go get Malira, and that'll
do
it.
Wow, Sam Pardee, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, Sam Pardee takes down game one there.
I have a Forest and a Malira in my deck.
Sam's a true master with this deck. He's won a Grand Prix with it. At the time, I talked to him, and he said he had played over 100 daily events with it on Magic Online.
Oh, I believe it.
Yeah.
So. I totally believe it.
All right, let's send you guys to a couple messages. We'll be right back.
Looking for that perfect card or just the right card sleeves and playmat for your next tournament? Gaming Etc. has what you're looking for. Use the promo code PTBNG to earn 10% off all singles and accessories at GamingEtc.com. Play Magic at a store near you every Friday. Earn Planeswalker points and battle against your friends in Friday Night Magic. February's FNM promo card is Elvish Mystic. Visit Wizards.com/FNM for more information.
And welcome back to the feature match area here at Pro Tour Born of the Gods. Let's take a look at what we're seeing here.
Which table are we at?
This looks like...
Oh, table
this
D,
this
the
is
text
a text table. Yes, so this is Tim Rivera versus Jingwei Zhang.
So it's blue-white-red control on the left. And it is it Splinter Twin on the right? Is that what's going on?
It does look like it, although I do see some white as well, so it could be blue-white-red control.
Yeah.
It could be blue-white-red.
I thought I heard an update about a Splinter Twin kill here. Maybe I'm just confused.
I mean, there is a deck that is Splinter Twin with white.
Right.
Though, if it's game one, you wouldn't expect to see a Geist of St. Traff there, I don't think.
Yeah. Rivera is Splinter Twin with white.
Okay.
Oh, I see. There aren't any. Yeah, Splinter Twin with white.
So that's
what's
Rivera's
going on the left of your screen.
Yeah, that's on the left-hand side. So that's Rivera. What
and
about
Jinwei Zhang is blue-white-red control.
Okay.
Little. He's got it. No, he's not. He's Blue Moon. That's what's going on. He's Blue Moon. 2 Batterskull, 2 Masters, couple Shackles, Blood Moons. Geist of St. Traft is... Where did that come from?
How is he getting away with that Geist in there? It's got to be just blue, white, red, huh?
Am I looking at the wrong deck list?
Maybe
I've been delivered the wrong deck list. There are 2 players named Zhang in the tournament. There's a Zhang with an A and a Zhang with an E.
Ah.
I've been given the wrong deck list. That's what's going on. Somewhere out there, there's a blue moon player who's missing a deck list. This is a blue, white, red control deck. The tempo version of the control deck. You can usually tell from the creature set. If they've got Geist... They're usually trying to play a little more of an aggressive game.
That's right. They're more on the burn end of the spectrum. I mean, this deck used to run Delver of Secrets. Like, there's the full spectrum for this 3-color pair.
I think spectrum is exactly the right word.
Yeah.
Super aggro, you can go to Delver, which is usually even only 2 colors. Mm-hmm. You can add white for sort of Geist Path and be a little more tempo-based.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you'll see Restoration Angel in these decks.
That's
sometimes
right.
You'll see Blade Splicer in these decks. Sometimes they're just, you know what, I'm going to go on the Sphinx's Revelation plan and just play Snapcaster Mages.
Yeah, where Celestial Colonnade ends up being the main win condition paired up with some burn spells. You see that quite a bit too. Snapcaster Mage, of course, a key component to that type of deck and has had a bit of a resurgence here.
Oh yeah, Snapcaster, in a world without Deathrite Shaman, Snapcasters is awesome.
It's awesome again, yeah.
Sorry, I haven't played much modern.
It was always pretty good anyway because it was always getting bolts and helixes and stuff back, which also kill Deathrite, but now you can point them at other things and still get your value every time.
Yeah, and then meanwhile on Rivera's side, you know, a lot of I did a deck tech with Patrick Dickman, which is he knows this deck inside and out. And he's the guy, you know, his version that he won Grand Prix Antwerp with was just blue-red. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of the versions had been white. I think that in this post-bannings world where Zoo is a major factor again, mm-hmm. having the white to be able to just play Wall of Omens and mm-hmm. block a Wild Nakadal, I feel like the white version of the deck has just gotten a lot better.
I've seen a lot of Wall of Omens out on
yeah,
the future matches.
Absolutely
it seems really well positioned right now.
And then Restoration Angel and having another four toughness creature in the Bell Ringer is nice because it means you just don't have to care about Anger of the Gods. In fact, you can run Anger of the Gods. Doesn't kill your Wallace, doesn't kill your Angel, doesn't kill your Bellringer.
Yeah, this one looks to be sort of in the middle range for what we were talking about with the blue-white-red. He's got two Geist of Saint Trapped, four Blade Splicer, and three Restoration Angels to complement the four Snapcaster Mages. Still the four Celestial Colonnade as finishers as well. So this is kind of in the middle.
Yeah, definitely on the tempo side rather than
absolutely.
The control side.
Absolutely.
Meanwhile, Rivera, this is game two, right? And Rivera's up a game?
Let's take a look here. Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah, and he's got Restoration Angel in his deck. He's got Kiki Jiki in his deck. I mean, we talk about it as a Splinter Twin deck, but you know what? Kiki Jiki Angel doesn't mm-hmm. require Splinter Twin.
No.
Just as good. Gotcha. Infinite Angels will get the job done. Just keep blinking your Kiki Jiki over and over.
And he's just valuing off here. Wall of Omens drawing him extra cards.
Sure. Haven't gotten a good look at their hands. Looks like it's just a Bolt in the Land for Zhang, so... If Rivera may not know it, but, oh, he's going to finish off the Angel? Oh, but Spellskite, of course.
Yeah,
redirects. Ouch.
Yeah, well, I mean, he blocked with the Angel.
Right.
Eats it, and then just uses his Spellskite.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure Zhang noticed.
I mean, this
the
was on board.
Or was
yeah, maybe
bluffing. He either fell for an onboard trick or was hoping Rivera would miss it.
Right.
These guys are X3, right?
Let's take a look here. They're both sitting on 10 wins.
All right, is Rivera... Can't tell if these guys... Keep putting his hand down. He's got a grip full of cards, so...
All right, why don't we head back to our number one feature match here and see how that's going to go. We still have Arjan Van Leeuwen and Sam Pardee waiting to get going here. And yes, this should be interesting. All right, here we are back in our main feature match. Here is Sam Pardee.
It's brutal.
Has kept, but he is going to get, well, no, nothing here. Just the rack to kick things off. I just assume that it's some type of one mana discard spell, but it's not. Sam Pardee plays a tapped land and ships a turn back here. This could open the door for a Dark Confidant here from Arjan if he wants to play it. You get a look at Sam Pardee's stats. He's had a lot of success with his deck. I'm sure he's been... very excited for this Pro Tour for quite a while.
A Grand Prix win with this deck, another Grand Prix top 8 with this deck, and then he also has a standard Grand Prix runner-up finish.
Mm-hmm.
Slippery Boggle goes all the way for Raymond Tan.
Ye old Bogle gets there.
There's a lot of that deck running around.
I mean,
I thought it was kind of
set for it.
Borderline top 10 deck coming in, but it's actually in the top 5 most played decks on day 2.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's the 5th most played deck on day 2.
Wow, that I do find that surprising. It usually tends to be an outlier.
Exactly. No, it's
it does seem
well positioned. Kind of a staple today.
We see that there's Liliana of the Veil for Arjan, but you know, we were talking to Willie Adel and he's down to one Liliana of the Veil in his Jund deck. You just don't see them as often anymore.
Yeah, which is good, which is part of the reason the coast was clear for the Boggles.
Exactly. Wow, Liliana of the Veil seems fantastic in Arjan's deck, though. Really able to fully take advantage of that plusing.
Everything that it does.
Yeah, and you know, and make it better for you than for your opponent in a really big way here. Here's a Wrench Mind as well. Man, Arjan's deck is awesome. No Spellskite to get rid of this time, so it's going to be a land and a Court of Calling. He does have a Malira Silvok Outcast sitting on the battlefield to complement his three other lands, but Sam Pardee has Entombed Exarch and Murderous Redcap in his hand still.
Yeah, Raymond Tan, we're talking about, he's now split with Ansi Alkio. Yep. Raymond Tan in his first Pro Tour.
Mm-hmm.
Pro Tour debut, he's from Malaysia. And then Alkio, we talked about, sitting on 7-0 in Modern. You know who else is 7-0 in Modern?
Who's that?
John Finkel.
Is he really?
Yeah.
And he's always good at draft, right?
Well, not this weekend.
Oh, no.
A pair of 1-2s.
1-2s?
Yeah. So
for
he's
John?
2-4 in draft, 7-0 in Modern. He's kind of hoping some tiebreaker miracle happens. Not holding his breath, I'm sure, but in position to put up a very strong finish. I think there's one other 7-0 player, but I don't remember who it was.
All right. Here's Murderous Redcap, and that's going to take down Dark Confidant.
Which
and
clears a path for Malira to take
clear
out
the way.
Liliana.
So big swing there for
yes.
Sam Pardee. Two permanents down while adding one to his own board. There's a Thoughtseize a turn late for Arjan. He's also got a Torpor Orb there. Shuts off a lot of the key interactions here for
yes,
the Birthing Pod deck. Let's see what he wants to do with his turn, though. He's going to Wrench Mind again, so he wants to get that last card out of Sam Pardee's hand.
Yeah, so Sam's taking six from the racks.
Wow, so this is actually going to go very quickly. Now, Arjan's on 17 and facing down four power here, so not nearly as quick of a clock for him. The onus is on Sam Pardee to come up with something. He drew
a creature. Comes up with Kitchen Finks.
A Kitchen Finks.
Yeah.
All right. Does that change the math here as far as number of turns that those racks are going to
Yeah, it does. It gives him a whole extra turn.
All right. Ooh.
Well, it
might
would
just
have.
Take one back again.
Jeez.
Back up to 11, but he's got his third the rack.
Wow.
And there's a Torpor Orb as well. So he's not going to leave back that,
so
that Mutavault.
So 3, 6, 9 damage, dropping
yeah.
Sam to 2. He's attacking for 2, 4, 7. Yeah, that third copy of the rack completely changed the math. He holds that card in his hand, but it's not good enough.
And
he's still scheduled to take
it.
Six. Wow.
Arjan Van Leeuwen takes the second game to force a game three, and that was an impressive, you know, I
it
guess
was rack off the
sometimes
top, right?
They have the three rack draw.
Yeah.
Is that how, that is just insane.
It pretty much came off the top, too. I think Sam was totally correct to play Kitchen Finks.
Mm.
Yeah, it was correct. I mean, I'm not even sure it would have helped him, even if he'd known about the third rack.
Mm-hmm. All right, why don't we jump over to
the King of the Hill table.
The King of the Hill table.
Yes. So, Sean McLaren versus Jacob Wilson. Sean McLaren from Canada is in his fourth round on the King of the Hill table. He took it, he defended it with a draw,
okay.
Then he defended it with a win, and now here he is defending it again. So,
I love this, by the way.
Yeah.
I'm getting a big kick out of the King of the Hill table.
So Jacob Wilson is sitting on 33 points. That is 11-2. McLaren is actually 10-1-1 at this point. Nobody's really run away with the standings. Like the top of the standings, you know, X2 is in second place. So,
mm-hmm. All right.
Tim Rivera did win that match against Zhiwing Zhang. He looked like he was in really good shape, just needed to kind of draw the kill spell there versus the blue-white-red control player that he'd run out of resources.
That's right.
And he did. So Zhang is picks up the dreaded fourth loss. Rivera plays on.
All right, so
McLaren is blue-white-red control.
Right.
Blue-white-red control. He's been hanging out at the top of the Swiss on the King of the Hill table for now his fourth round in a row. Wilson, meanwhile, is...
He's on Malira Pod
as well.
He's on the same list that... well, at least the same deck that Pardee is playing. They're friends.
Yeah, no, they're both their teammates, right?
They're teammates and friends. Yeah.
I believe I heard that. So face-to-face games, is you know, the Canadian team,
mm-hmm.
the players who are doing the best seem to be the Pod players.
Mm.
It's Sam. I believe there's three of them that are as essentially playing the same basic list.
That's right.
I think they've all been doing well. But it's did we say McLaren's up a game here? No, Wilson's up a game. Can't read your notes.
I don't know if we know if either of them is.
Wilson's up a game.
Wilson's up a game, all right.
Well, we may see Pod again.
Yeah, I had Josh McLean down in the feature match area last round. He's also doing very well, sitting with three losses on the same deck.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty nice when you have Sam Pardee on your team and you can just him how to play the deck because it's obviously a very difficult deck to pilot.
Yeah, my way of studying this deck in order to get ready for commentary was to watch Sam Pardee videos.
Yeah, is that right?
Yeah, here's a daily video with Sam Pardee playing Malira Pod. Here's another daily with Sam Pardee playing Malira Pod.
There you go.
That's how you learn the deck.
So our main feature match still getting shuffled up for their game three. We're going to be bringing you that once they're ready to go. That's Arjan Van Leeuwen versus Sam Pardee. Van Leeuwen, three racks in game two, took it down for him.
Catherine.
The rack.
Yeah, now the third one was off the top, too, when he had to have it.
Yep. Here's a Lightning Helix from McLaren. Take down one Noble Hierarch here. Not a lot going on for Wilson on his side of the board. He's really only been able to come up with... Oh, one Noble Hierarch.
Well, Stony Silence isn't good news. Basically turns off any Birthing Pods that Wilson might draw.
22. Little insurance plan there.
Yeah, I mean, part of the strategy for red, white, blue against Maliripod is just kill all the creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see from McLaren's graveyard, you know, he's gone through some burn, he's gone through some Snapcaster mages, now seems to be at the point where he's turning his attention to Wilson himself.
That's right.
So that was Snapcaster, and that Lightning Helix didn't get pointed at the Hierarch.
No.
Especially with Stony Silence in play, he's not as worried about killing all the creatures as his way to attack the pod.
Right.
He's attacking the pod with the Stony Silence, and now he's attacking Wilson's life total.
And that is the trick. It's the hard part to do that, is to balance out when to start action, because you've got to use all these resources to keep him off pod. Why don't we head back over to our main feature match area here, where we're going to get our game three with the mono black modern list here of Arjan Van Leeuwen. He's playing against Sam Pardee, and looks like we're ready to go. Here they go. And a nice start here for Sam Pardee. He kicks things off with a Noble Hierarch, giving him access potentially turn two birthing pod. Mm-hmm. Though, let's see what Arjan... Yeah, he's going to Thoughtseize here and make sure. It looks like...
Pardee had a mulligan to six, kept four land and two Noble Hierarchs. So when he saw the Thoughtseize, he just put Noble Hierarch straight into the graveyard because it was the only legal choice.
Wow, was that a pod off the top
pod
for Pardee?
Pod off the top!
Boom! Now he's in business again. So the ideal draw there for Sam Pardee. He can start chaining things together now. Let's see what Arjan Van Leeuwen can do.
Wow.
Looks like he has a pretty land-heavy hand here.
Well, Pardee had a land-heavy hand until he top-decked his perfect card.
Indeed. In general, I think
What is that?
That's Smallpox.
Oh, that's Smallpox. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, so he killed the Noble Hierarch. That means Pardee has no creatures.
And a land.
Well, the creature was the crucial part, what with Birthing Pod.
Yeah, he's setting him back quite a lot here. And there's
Noble
a creature
Hierarch off
the top.
Sam Pardee's deck loves him. He loves the deck, and the deck has loving him back right now.
Wow.
Hierarch turns into Voice of Resurgence, which he can pod into two creatures.
Yep.
Jeez.
You see Arjan scratch his head there like, geez,
I thought I
had a good plan here.
Yes. Historically, that's been the problem with mono black discard, right? You can't make them discard the top card of their library.
That's right. It is true.
You know, you knock everything out of their hand, but you can't control their top decks.
And remember, Arjan's down a land here, too, thanks to that Smallpox. Yeah. He's got a Dark Confidant to help start generating card advantage, but Sam Pardee just does way more powerful things with his Birthing Pod. Every turn, he's going to be generating advantage and potentially building up his combo as well.
Yep. Yeah, he's not interested in offering a block.
There was no trade offered.
Gain two. Your turn.
So here's a Kitchen Finks now. Gain two life back for Sam Pardee. And give him also the now 2/2 elemental. And here's Dark Confidant trigger. Couldn't quite see what it was there.
Was it a Shrieking Affliction?
Okay.
So we're 16 each, right?
Yeah. All right, got another update from our back table there.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I didn't...
Raymond Tan down. It looks like Ansi Alkio has defeated him 2-1.
Okay. Wow, 8-0 now.
That agrees with what I had. I just didn't deal you damage to Smallpox.
All right, so let's take a look at Arjan Van Leeuwen's hand there. You get to see it. He's going to play out that Shrieking Affliction. And he still has his Dark Confidant going, but you got to feel like Sam Pardee's in a really good spot, Randy, with two creatures out, one of them, well, both of them potable, but one of them potable twice.
Yeah, the only scary part is that he has no cards in his hand. So, mm-hmm. I mean, he's vulnerable to, you know, rack coming off the top, something like that.
Okay.
But yeah, it shouldn't take long for Birthing Pod to put him into a good position.
All right, we're going to get a game three on our King of the Hill table as well. Sean McLaren evens things up with Jacob Van Leeuwen. Both of those players are sitting near the top of the heap here, 34 points in the tournament versus 33. Sorry, I said Jacob Van Leeuwen. Obviously, I meant Jacob Wilson.
Yeah, Redcap taking out the Bob. Really nice play for Pardee there. It sort of reduces Van Leeuwen's ability to stitch together, you know, a couple copies of the rack and some discard spells. He's got Raven's Crime. So he can make keep Pardee with an empty hand.
He does actually just play a swamp there afterwards. Interesting here, Randy. We see this often from the Birthing Pod deck. He's just valuing him out at this point, right?
Yep.
Just like 2-for-1 with Murderous Redcap like we did in Limited.
Mm-hmm. And Pardee doesn't need cards in his hand. He doesn't really care about Raven's Crime. He's got everything he needs in play.
That's right.
So Birthing Pod sacrifices Kitchen Finks. He's going to go get...
He can go get Ranger and then get a Viscera Seer that he can actually cast. He's just going to gain some life.
Ravenous Baloth.
You got to love that versus the discard deck, but he's just going to get it right
Obstinate
into play.
Baloth, yeah,
Obstinate Baloth. Gain 4 life here and really just put up a bunch of beef, and
there's
that's going to do it. Arjan Van Leeuwen falls to Sam Pardee. Master of Birthing Pod.
Yeah, really a clinic. You saw crisp play, quick play. Sam knew exactly what mattered. He knew exactly what needed.
Yeah, I mean, pot off the top, I was like...
Also, it's kind of nice when you know what you need and then you draw it.
Yeah, the pot off the top was obviously gigantic.
It was.
And then Van Leeuwen had the answer of kill your only creature, but a creature came off the top. And
so it looks like we can go over to probably our King of the Hill match, Jacob Wilson versus Sean McLaren over there.
Yeah, I think that's the only feature match left.
I believe so, and they're going to be in their Game 3 decider once they're underway. So we'll see if... you said that Sean McLaren has been on that table now for 4 rounds. This is his 4th round in a row.
It is.
See if he can make it 5. Yeah, Jacob Wilson's not going to make that easy for him. And it looks like the players are... just getting done sideboarding, shuffling, and presenting decks here. So we're going to get the whole entire Game 3 for you here as we wind down our matches. Just a few more left here from Pro Tour here in Valencia.
Now, if McLaren wins this game, he's on 11-1-1, 12-1-1?
He's on 34 points right now.
So we've played 13
so
rounds.
11-1-1.
He's 11-1-1. If he gets to 12-1-1 with just 2 rounds left... he can, in theory, go loss-loss. He's on X3-1, which everyone seems to think makes the top 8.
Okay.
So I actually think that if McLaren wins this game, we have our first top 8 member.
Wow. That's incredible.
Yeah.
And it was all because of King of the Table. He just didn't want to give it up.
Inspired by the King of the Hill, yeah. King of the Hill, if you stay there long enough, you win the Pro Tour. That's how it works.
I mean...
Everybody comes to you. If they can't knock you off the hill, you win.
But... mighty champions are sent forth to help knock you off. Jacob Wilson, one of them for sure. Really a brilliant young player.
Definitely. You know, and he's still sitting. There's 3 rounds to go, and he's actually got a loss to give, right? Sitting on X and 2. So, I mean, if he wins this, he's probably in, right? If he wins this match, then he'll be sitting on X and 2. Loss-loss would be 4 losses, but he'll probably get a chance to draw. So Jacob Wilson, if he with a win here, would be in pole position.
So this is just an absolutely massive match for both of these players.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, I know everyone counts, but this is just huge. I mean, if either of them is essentially playing for top 8 here, this early in the tournament, too.
Right. I mean, I think McLaren mathematically clinches it, and Wilson all but clinches it.
Okay.
I mean, it's not a super clean winning in, but it's very close to that. And now it's, one game. I mean, there aren't very many players who had a better record than 10 and 3 coming into this. There are actually only 4 players that were above the 10 and 3 mark.
Okay.
Now, the 10 and 3s are, there were 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14 of them.
Okay.
So, I mean, they were essentially playing, win, win, win or win, win, draw.
So that's the slugfest down there. They're going to be battling hard.
Yeah, but the 4 guys that were above the fray were these two. Then Christian Siebold played Shi Tian Li, which was not featured, right?
Correct.
So we haven't heard that result.
And that's Affinity versus Blue Moon.
Blue Moon, yeah. The Blue Moon was on X1 and 2, where that second draw is kind of...
just very annoying.
That's the painful one, because it's the two draws is effectively a loss. It's worse than a loss.
All right, so here we go. Sean McLaren, he's also had success with Blue, White, Red, and Modern, and he's playing against Jacob Wilson, who just plays a Kitchen Finks. Now, Sean's going to crack a fetch in response here, and pretty reasonable chance we see this... mana leaked or remanded or something.
Yeah, Wilson's got Abrupt Decay. He does have a Birthing Pod in his hand.
He does. Now, that's something that Sean McLaren has to be hyper aware of. He hasn't had a chance to see his hand, and he won't. But here's Mana Leak on Kitchen Finks. So you mentioned it before, Randy. Looks like Sean's on the keep creatures off your board play.
Right.
I mean, plus Kitchen Finks is just a problem, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
no,
it just gets very annoying and keeps on attacking. Now he's going to pass a turn back after playing a land here. And there's a nice draw for Jacob Wilson. He picks up a Voice of Resurgence here.
Yeah, it's particularly good against a deck with a lot of counterspells in it.
That's right. So let's see what he goes for. He goes for Kitchen Finks again. So he has another Kitchen Finks in his hand. He's going to run this one out. And Sean says, yeah, okay, well... Can't counter them all.
Yeah, the only efficient way for McLaren to deal with the Kitchen Finks is with a permission spell. Mm-hmm. If you kill it with Lightning Bolt, you're not done.
Yeah, you're not done with that job yet.
Although Path to Exile does also deal with it efficiently.
It does.
Removing it from the game means the Persist doesn't trigger.
Yeah, you know, Sean also has a couple of other reasonable ways. He can bolt it and then use, like, maybe half of an Electrolyze to kill it off, get a card back, and not feel too bad. But it's still, it's annoying. Right. I mean, that card does work.
I mean, like, see, it affects a lot of card choices, too. I mean, it's annoying enough that people are playing removed from game effects instead of just damage.
That's right. All right, Sean with two Sphinx's Revelations in his hand. So his job is clear here. Go long.
That's both of them.
Yeah, it is. Okay.
Yeah, he only plays two.
Yeah, most of these decks run one or two.
I mean, it's certainly nice if you get to the mid game, you can kind of, you know, push your opponent over the edge.
Yeah, having two in hand at this point in the game
doesn't seem good
at all, though.
Definitely not.
All right, Kitchen Finks into the red zone. Sean McLaren's on 17 life. He has plenty of life to work with currently. He does have to be aware of it, though. Yes, the Birthing Pod deck is a combo deck that can deal you, you know, a million life at once, but it also can just play a bunch of really good creatures and just run you over with them. It happens a lot.
Yeah, McLaren's hand is... These two Sphinx's Revelations are not ideal, but Mana League, Snapcaster is kind of nice. Oh, you see here, Jacob Wilson's doing an excellent job of playing around Mana League.
Yeah, he plays his land first.
And he played a two-mana spell instead of any of the more expensive spells in his deck.
All right, and Sean McLaren is forced to just basically cycle his first Sphinx's Revelation there in response.
Yeah, he didn't want to create a token, obviously.
That's right. So he draws a card. He wants to make sure he keeps hitting his land drops, and he does find a Sacred Foundry there.
And now the coast is clear for the Birthing Pod.
Wow. Expert play there from Jacob Wilson.
Absolutely.
And look at his board state now. He's in a beautiful position. Sean McLaren really didn't want to give Jacob the token, and as a result, he now has a Birthing Pod on his side and a main phase Sphinx's Revelation for two here.
Yeah,
desperation mode, right? I mean,
yeah, Voice of Resurgence means he has to do it main phase. Like,
yeah. I'm just saying, if that's your play for the turn, you divinationed. This can't be good if you're on Sean McLaren's side of the table.
Voice of Resurgence is the card the Pod deck wants against control.
Yeah.
That is why it's in the deck. You see, really, the Pod deck is a bunch of utility creatures and, you know, a bunch of one-offs. The creatures that they play multiples of, though, are the two that are in play. Mm-hmm. It's Voice of Resurgence so that you can beat up on the control decks, and it's Kitchen Finks so that you can beat up on the Zoo decks.
On the creature decks, yep.
Yeah, I mean, Zoo in particular, but any creature deck.
Uh-huh. And they're both fantastic targets to sacrifice as they essentially replace themselves.
Yeah. Four Kitchen Finkses.
All right, here's five damage. And like we were talking about before, you know, this can just get out of hand, too. Another thing that Jacob Wilson has is he has Gavinny Township active as well, which works well with Kitchen Finks. If it were to die, he can start putting counters back on it, reset it.
Yeah, remember 2 turns ago when it seemed like McLaren had a bunch of stuff and everything was fine?
That was so long ago.
Yeah, he sacrifices Voice of Resurgence, so he gets a token and he's going to go get a 3-mana creature. What's he going to get?
Sin Collector is going to take a look at Sean McLaren's fairly stacked hand, though. It's only going to be able to hit a Lightning Bolt or a Mana Leak, leaving Sean with two Snapcaster Mages and two lands. Minor upgrade there.
The voice was doing pretty good work there.
We went from a playing card to a dice to a dice on a sleeve and now an official token. No, this is not an official token. It's a turned over token. But it is a Voice of Resurgence elemental token. And there it is. And Jacob Wilson takes Lightning Bolt. Does he have another play here? We know he's got the Abrupt Decay in his hand. And he's going to activate Township and pass a turn back. Not a lot going here for Sean McLaren, but Jacob Wilson, again, playing very smartly here.
Yeah, I mean, the good news is there's not a Voice of Resurgence in play, and he's allowed to cast spells on Jacob Wilson's turn now. I mean, I guess that's good news. Never feels good, though, because Wilson chose to get rid of Voice of Resurgence. Wilson felt like he could do better than that.
That's right. I mean, he is very much on the beatdown plan here. Sean McLaren doesn't have a whole lot going on. Those mana leaks are terrible now because Jake, A, knows about him. Yeah, and B, just doesn't care. He has his own birthing pod engine going here. And he's also got, what, 3, 7, 10 power on the board right now? I mean, doesn't he just have lethal? We know about the Snapcasters.
Snapcaster can block.
Right. But, I mean, he can just force the issue without really doing much else.
Gavinny Township is shockingly good in this deck.
It sure is.
It really looks innocuous when you look at the deck list, and it's just hanging out in the land spots. But
yeah, you lose to it a lot. And there's a scavenging news to kick things off for Wilson.
This is where most of the wins come from. It's creatures, Gavinny Township, just attacking. Okay, scavenging news threatening to make those Snapcasters irrelevant.
All right, so Snapcaster Mage targeted Sphinx's Revelation here.
Yeah, well, this is all as a response to the scavenging news.
Right.
The only way McLaren's going to get any value out of Snapcaster is before the scavenging news resolves and can start picking away at the creatures. Although, interestingly, if scavenging news ate something here, it would actually turn off Gavinny Township for a turn.
So Jacob's going to have to try to decide.
Oh, so are we end step? The ooze resolved and
McLaren
is tempting him?
I don't think we've gone to attacks yet. Okay. Yeah, so now we're in attacks. Everybody's battling. And there's Abrupt Decay to take down Snapcaster Mage.
Uncounterable. No blocker for you.
Now, we're still before blocks, though. Sean McLaren has another Snapcaster in his hand.
How much damage is it?
It's 1, 2, 3, 4... 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
And McLaren's at 11.
That's right. And Jacob Wilson cannot activate Township here, though.
Right.
He can certainly just pot away, though, the Sin Collector and just go get a Murderous Red Cap to finish the deal post-combat here.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah.
Nope, that's going to do
it. McLaren knew that's what could happen, so he extends the hand.
Wow, Jacob Wilson putting
new
on a show
King
here.
Of the Hill.
Indeed, takes the hill. And it looks like we're going to get to have a chat with Jacob Wilson shortly.
Yeah,
you think
awesome.
He'll forgive me for forgetting his name for a minute there? I hope he does. So that's going to be it for our feature match areas right now. But we are getting right down into the nitty-gritty here as we move down. Welcome back to the booth, guys. Marshall Sutcliffe here with Randy Bueller. So you were saying that the winner of that match, if it was Sean McLaren, would be mathematically good to go. What does it mean for him that he didn't win?
He's X2-1, so if we're right about the X3 ones all getting in, he needs to split the next two.
Okay, so he has to
still
win.
Still has a loss to give.
Now,
but if he goes win-loss in any order, then he'll be 3 losses and a draw. He'll be fine.
Now, we're thinking that Jacob Wilson is good to go at this point, but it's not necessarily.
He's going to need to pick up an intentional draw at some point. But yeah, he. I don't think he'll be in a position to draw. It actually depends on that other match.
Okay.
Like, there's a chance he'll get a draw. There's a chance he'll have to play for it, but he's in great shape.
All right. Well, why don't we head down to the feature match area for a quick word with Jacob Wilson right now.
Thanks, Marshall. Rashad Miller here with Jacob Wilson. Now, during your pregame procedures, I kind of walked over and took a look at the game and watched you guys sideboard, and you took a deep sigh, you know, deep breath, like you needed to calm yourself. Exactly what, in your mind, what was riding on that game 3?
We were playing for top 8 of the Pro Tour, and like something that I've wanted to do ever since I learned that the Pro Tour existed, and it's great to finally done it.
Well, at the tender age of 18, you've already played in 6 Pro Tours?
This is my 6th Pro Tour.
All right, so you look at your opening hand, and you see persist creatures and other creatures that are just really resilient. Were you liking your chances then?
Yeah, my hand was really good at attrition, and in this matchup it was great. So I was very excited to see my hand.
Well, I want to congratulate you for dethroning the King of the Hill and playing a masterful game. So Rashad Miller, going to send it back to the booth with Marshall and Randy.
Thanks. Hey guys, welcome back. I have 2 comments. The first one, his Twitter name, Jacob Wilson 95.
I saw it,
too. A little depressing.
I saw it, too.
The other one is that his teammates are rooting him on from the rail here as
Yeah.
I saw Todd Anderson and Sam Pardee, you know, kind of waiting for him to come over there. All right, we're ready to head back over to the news desk. Now, when we come back, we'll have 3 of us in the booth to close out day 2 here from Pro Tour Born of the Gods. See you guys in a bit.
All right, thanks very much to Marshall Sutcliffe, Randy Buehler there in the booth. Let me bring you some of the key results from this round. Some of the feature match areas, some not. So Sam Pardee still alive. He has his 11th win. Arjan Van Leeuwen, fourth loss. Difficult. Zheng of New Zealand, 10 wins still, trouble. Rivera of the United States, 11th win, good news. Sean McLaren, Jacob Wilson, you've just seen. Jacob Wilson wins, goes to 36 points. McLaren on 34, very much in his destiny in own hands. Then Anssi Alkio wins over Raymond Tan. Tan's fourth loss. Alkio still alive, we believe, 11-3. Now, away from the feature match area, Michael Hetrick was playing against Jared Butcher. Butcher with that incredible ad nauseum lightning strike deck. Butcher wins. That puts Hetrick to 2-4 on day two. He was 8-0, the overnight leader, but he is 2-4 today, and that means we think that Hetrick is gone, although because he was the overnight leader, maybe he's the one that might sneak in at 12-4, if anyone does, because obviously his tie breaks will have been fantastic coming in. But let's see how things go. Now, Josh McLean, he's had his fourth loss because Patrick Dickman, the modern master of European magic, won the Antwerp GP with Splinter Twin, added green for Tarmo Twin. We did a deck tech earlier on. He wins. So then, Fennell and Perez Jr., they are still going at 10 wins apiece. And then Christian Sable, this is a huge result. We have a huge result. So Christian Sabod of Germany was up against Li Shi Chan of Hong Kong. Li had already picked up two draws, remember. 10 wins, two draws and a loss coming in. Sabold, well, he hadn't had any draws. He was just beating people. He was at 11 wins. And that goes all the way up to 12 wins now. So Christian Sabold at 12 wins, that puts him right on the verge of the top eight. The way it looks like, we're going to see Wilson against Sabold in the penultimate round, and they may well be able to ID themselves into the sunset of Sunday. So that is what's going to happen as we see. So Hetrick, we think, gone. Butcher alive. Dickman alive. McLean gone. Fennell Perez Jr. still battling it out for an 11th win. Sabold 12. Li Shi Chan still alive. 10-2-2. 32 points. He's going to make the math super hard. If he wins the penultimate round, goes to 35, he would then get to 38. We have a deck tech coming up, but first, I'll tell you a little secret. Ever since approximately, well, Wednesday, this guy and I have been waiting for this 10 minutes right now. Because it's time for the crazy combos. Hello, Randy, how are you?
I'm good. More, some cool matches.
Yes, some cool matches. And you said to me, the thing about the crazy combos is they're so crazy that they're not necessarily that crazy.
Well, that's modern, right? There are so many decks, there are so many cards, and all of the decks, you know, if you come up with the key card to put it over the top, you know, maybe it's a good deck. You know, the best decks in the format are consistent and resilient and, you know, powerful. Sometimes, though, you have, like, the powerful piece, you haven't figured out the consistency. And anyway, yeah, when I was putting together the top 20 overview for the format, you know, there were some things that I saw that I knew people were testing for the Pro Tour or just stumbled across, and I just, you know, started collecting some of the crazy things that people can do in Modern that, you know, probably aren't going to turn into a Pro Tour-worthy deck, but who knows?
So let's be honest, we could do an hour on this easily. I'm going to give you 2 minutes on each of these.
All right.
Starting now, what is crazy thing number one, Randy?
Crazy thing number one, Paradise Mantle. So this is an equipment that taps, that basically turns your creature into a Bird of Paradise. But if you think back to the Lorwyn block, there were multiple creatures with the untap mechanic, like the Patrol Signaler. Now, you put Paradise Mantle on Patrol Signaler. Imagine there's a Training Grounds in play to reduce the activation cost. Now, I tap it for mana. Oh, I spend the mana and untap to make a guy. I tap it for mana. I make a guy. I tap it. I untap it. I tap it. I untap it. All of a sudden, I have infinite guys. So it's kind of like a bad version of the Splinter Twin combo at first. I mean, it takes three cards instead of two, but there's other cards that you can flesh the deck out with. You put Judge of Currents in your deck, Pure Sight Marrow in your deck. Is it Guildmage happens to combo with Training Grounds?
Oh, wow.
And suddenly you've got like three or four different sort of three card combos that, you know, you draw any two of them and the deck kind of sort of works. Anyway, this is just an example of some of the crazy stuff that goes on.
That is fantastic. Now, Paradise Mantle, the one we've got up there, comes from Modern Masters. Sure. But originally that was, where was that from back in the day?
No, I don't even remember.
I'm trying to think. But Patrol Signaler, you see from the Lorwyn
block. Yeah, it's the untapped mechanic with Paradise Mantle is really, there's multiple untapped creatures that can combo, especially if you've got Training Grounds in play already.
It's interesting to think that Inspired, talking to Tom LaPalle and Zach Hill, there was a point during development of Born of the Gods when people were talking about Inspired and something to do with untap, and they someone came up with this idea, and then in the same meeting someone went, wait a minute, isn't that a little bit like the untap symbol we've seen somewhere before? So that is crazy thing number one, Infinite Guys with Paradise Mantle, untap, Training Grounds. All right, I think I understood that one. Okay. Crazy thing number two is
Norn the Wary. Norn the Wary. I remember I was on the team that built this card.
Okay.
And it has been for years legendary as being one of the worst creatures of all time. It's a 1-mana 2/1. That part sounds exciting, but it can't do anything. It can't attack. It can't block. It keeps hiding. He's so scared, he keeps leaving. But you know what? If you have Soul Warden and if you have Soul's Attendant, having a creature that can come in and out of play is actually kind of good. You'll gain multiple life. And you know what? There's a white weenie deck called Soul Sisters, which is kind of a shell. You know, I didn't see anybody playing it at the Pro Tour, but I mean, it's sort of a borderline almost good enough deck anyway.
It's a deck Conley Woods has played a bunch of times. In fact, did he not create Soul Sisters? I think he did.
I don't know. Johnny's Pride Maid is happy when you're gaining life. Ascendant's happy when you're gaining life. So yeah, the Soul Sisters, the Soul Warden, the Soul's Attendant, you throw Norn the Wary in there and all of a sudden the deck just goes nuts. Like, I actually saw this deck win on Magic Online. You know, there were dailies where, you know, the Norn the Wary deck got the job done. Worst creature of all time, but he's got this niche ability that if you find the right way to exploit it, it's not the worst creature of all time. It's exactly what this deck needed.
People were so cross with you when they opened boosters and found that in their rare slot.
Well, put Porphyros in play too. Now how do you feel about having a creature bouncing in and out of play all the time?
Okay, I'm not that upset anymore. Crazy thing number two is Norn the Wary. Right. Ah, Modern's just great. All right, that's two crazy things. And I did understand that one too. I was like, fine, give me number three.
Number three is Death Shadow.
Pardon?
1-mana 13/13 creature that nobody plays because, of course, you want to play your one drop on the first turn, and this guy just gets -X/-X for your life total.
So it starts out as a -7/-7.
Yeah, we're not going to play him. We're going to get him into the graveyard, and then we're going to play Varals. And Varals means all your creatures have scavenge.
Right.
Death Shadow's a lot better if you put the scavenge ability on him. Now you pay 1-mana, and you give somebody else +13/+13.
Ah.
Pretty good.
Okay, yes.
1-mana, +13/+13 permanently. I mean, they're +1/+1 counters.
Yeah.
And it turns out there's actually a deck you can play this in. There's a deck called Dredgevine, which specializes in just putting good creatures into the graveyard and using them. Lotless Troll is often the best enabler. You've also seen Hedron Crab in that deck.
Right.
You know, Vengevine is one of the key creatures. I put that in the graveyard, play something, get my free Vengevines. So you can definitely build a graveyard synergy deck. And with Deathrite Shaman, Luvik, I know this deck at least got tested for the Pro Tour. I didn't see any of them actually show up, but I mean, it's actually close. You know, the Dredgevine deck is close. Death Shadow may actually fit in that. I don't know how crazy this one is. This feels like there's a deck that's like maybe one or two tweaks away from being a real thing.
That's interesting because Vengevine we've seen in the top eight of Pro Tour. Oh, yeah. It's like Proto Paris 2011. So, that's a card that's the real deal. And that's super naughty, isn't it, really? Because that's the one that kind of feels like cheating because Norn the Wary, you are actually doing what it says, right?
Right.
And Paradise Mantle, you are doing what it says.
Right. Death Shadow with Scavenge feels, that was not the ideal.
That feels rude.
That's what the powerful stuff in Modern feels like, right?
Absolutely.
You found a way to break it.
All right, three down, two to go. Crazy thing number four is
the best tooth and nail ever. All right, so let's say you've got 9 green mana lying around.
As I so often do.
Well, if you play with Nykthos, you can. Like, if you've got, you know, Nykthos sort of green devotion, this sort of, I saw this deck online. It was a Nykthos green devotion deck. I was like, what am I going to do with all my green mana? I'll get a tooth and nail. What's the best thing I can tooth and nail in? Well, let's say you get Tyrant of Discord. What Tyrant of Discord does is your opponent loses a permanent at random. Shuffle up their permanents, choose one at random, it's gone.
That doesn't sound terribly good.
Well, the problem is if you hit a land, you have to stop. Okay, so having them lose permanence is good, but if you hit a land, you have to stop. So the trick is, the other half of your tooth and nail is a Realm Razor,
right?
So all their lands are gone. So first all their lands go away, and then Tyrant of Discord says, lose a permanent. Is it a land?
No, it's not a land.
Lose another permanent. Is it a land?
It's still not a land, though.
Right, lose all your permanents. So all your lands are gone, all your non-lands are gone. Your turn.
It's not that good, though, is it? I mean, you've only got like a 7-7 and a 4-2. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
They could so easily come back into the game from there.
Exactly.
Planes, Path to Exile the Tyrant, Take 4 from the Realm. Oh, I'm not convinced by this one. No, I mean, that's... that's the what I would call the ultimate combo there, because it is... Although I'm doing both of two things,
right.
It is the synergy of the two things that's so redonkulous.
Yeah, that was actually when I was, that was the combo I stumbled across. I was just laughing out loud for minutes and had to go start creating the list of crazy things to keep track of for the Pro Tour.
I love that. I hope five is going to be equally as exciting because we've had four.
Well, here's the thing. I built these slides earlier this week.
Yeah.
We thought we were going to do this piece yesterday during the Modern Overview.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's like maybe these things make the Pro Tour, and they're kind of crazy combos. But yeah, let's see number five.
All right, so the big one here, it is...
Oh, Amulet of Vigor.
It's Matthias Hunt's deck.
Yeah, it is Matthias Hunt's deck. That's exactly right. You know what? It turns out if you put Amulet of Vigor in play, bounce lands come into play untapped. You can make a bunch of mana. You could Summer's Bloom. I don't know if it's good enough to make the Pro Tour.
It is.
It turns out it is. Yeah, there were five copies of an Amulet of Vigor deck played at this Pro Tour. Matthias Hunt famously got all the way to the end of yesterday before finally picking up a loss. And yeah, the Amulet of Vigor deck, super cool, kind of crazy. Hive Mind, I think, is the tech that put it over the top. And I also thought Matthias Hunt's other tweak was the Simeon Spirit Guides that allow you to do things like turn one Summer Bloom, so he can actually explode his mana base even without an Amulet of Vigor.
Right.
I think that was the consistency that, you know, I saw the combo that was really good if you have an Amulet of Vigor, and he's found ways to make the deck better even if you don't.
Well, that's what Josh Utter-Layton said to me, because we were chatting over a Matthias Hunt match, because I knew he was playing this and wanted to see what was going on. And Josh said, yeah, that deck's amazing with an opening hand Amulet of Vigor. It's terrible without one. But the Simeon Spirit Guide makes a big difference there, yeah.
But just more testament to how crazy things is in Modern. We saw we saw Ad Nauseam. I'm thinking Tendrils, because it's usually Ad Nauseam Tendrils. It's not a Tendrils kill in Modern, but the Ad Nauseam engine works just fine, just like it does in the other Eternal formats.
Yeah, and Jared Butcher is utterly still alive at 11-3. He needs a win.
Absolutely
here. Absolutely
top 8 contention.
Yeah, we could see him tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, I saw people playing Xur the Enchanter, Rage Forger, Tallow Wisp, Dark Prophecy, Protean Hulk. There's crazy stuff going on in Modern. It's a really fun format. So many decks, so many things going on.
When I was asking you for the preview article on MagicTheGathering.com, and I said, look, what's the story with Modern? What should new players look out for? And you said, the thing is, anyone can play anything for as long as they want to play it, basically.
Right. Absolutely. That's what this format does.
And these things aren't even on any of the here's your starter 2025 deck list that you might want to have a look at. Five crazy things in Modern with the King of the Crazy Combo. And I didn't think I'd call you that on air, Randy Bueller. You're going to head back to the booth, I know, because we're heading down the stretch. Between us, we'll sort all the maths.
Sounds good.
God willing. All right. So that's Randy Bueller there, waiting patiently for us. He's very kind. He's from the Netherlands. We have a deck tech coming right up. It's super cool because it's got Shrieking Affliction in it. Who doesn't love that in Modern? That's a crazy card for you. Here he is, Brian David Marshall with Arjan Van Leeuwen, deck tech. Now,